Another question relating work and energy, just to really drive home the formatting that is the most helpful in solving these problems. You'll find that most of these problems flow pretty much the same way. So as typical with any work and energy kind of problem, it relates an initial condition and a final condition, tracking all the work in between. So it's really quite important to make a quick sketch of the situation. So at time one, you're over here, moving at 2 meters per second. At time two, you're over here and running even faster, draw some speed lines, because you're now at 8 meters per second. All the while, your displacement is 25 meters. So if you were to list out the relevant information in a little table, so it's well kept track of, defining your height to be zero at that on the ground, positive upwards, doesn't really matter because it's the same before and after. Then in between, you want to draw your free body diagram, looking at again, what is the body touching as always. So you have Fn from the ground, you have some kind of wind force resisting his motion forward. You have, of course, an Fg. And then they're specifically asking about the force the sprinter exert on the track, but we already talked about how through Newton's third law, because the runner pushes on the ground backwards, the ground pushes forward on the runner. Making a note that this thing we're getting here is actually the negative of the force we're actually looking for. This here is what we're after, the force of the runner on the ground. But they end up being the same magnitude anyways by Newton's third law. Once we have all that set up, then we will write out the entire energy balance. I always recommend starting with this one, even though it's quite lengthy, but it does cover all the situations so that you can cross things away as you need instead of memorizing and try and work out in your head which situation specifically we're talking about. Once everything is listed, we can say, oh, well, the potential energy is the same before and after. That's easy. And in this case, nothing else really cancels out. So off we go. This work term, we have to do it for all the non-conservative forces. So again, gravity is not included. We do have the wind, the normal force, and the ground, basically. So knowing that our displacement goes, in my case, to the right, we can see that this has an angle of 180 degrees. So we know that this first work term has a negative 1 multiply in front of it. Cosine 180 is negative 1. Normal force, as usual, doesn't do any work because the angle between the force and the displacement is 90 degrees. In this case, the ground force and the displacement has the same direction, so theta of 0. Cosine of 0 is just 1. So that becomes this part over here. So to isolate my ground force, which we want to solve for, we want to put and subtract KE1 onto the other side, and also shift the work done by the wind on the other side as well. Negative becomes a positive. I guess now I will expand the kinetic energy term into 1/2 mv squared. And then subbing in the numbers, we'll get our answer. And finally, knowing that by Newton's third law, we're not talking about the forward force from the ground, we're talking about the backward force from the runner on the ground. So that's why we have to stress that it's backwards. Of course, you could have done the whole question using the free body diagram and saying, oh, if I know the A, which I do because I can use Vf squared minus V1 squared equals 2A delta D, find the A and then summing forces is equal to Ma, right? We'll get the same answer, but this is just a different way of doing it. So sometimes it might be faster. So it's good to have both these approaches in kind of our toolbox that we're building up.